some of the liquid going through the evaporator, and we're going to go ahead and valve this thing off on the suction side. And once it's done, then we'll shut it off, then we'll valve off the high side. You can't do that ahead of time. You try to valve off the high side on the discharge of the compressor and you're going to blow things up. This thing should have pumped down a lot faster than this. It basically isn't pumping down, which is the whole reason why we're changing the compressor. Now, I did adjust this compressor so that it would shut off a little sooner, so that we kind of get it shut off in between our defrost, but it shut off at 12 pounds of pressure, so we're going to go ahead and valve up our high side, and then we'll recover the last bit of the machine, of course. So we got our recovered, everything's zeroed out. We're completely isolated on our high side. I know for a fact this is the breaker for it. I was just here the other day to be extra precautious. Go ahead and pull the fuses. Which, speaking of fuses, might as well look at these. They all are FRN30s. Now we just need to get these bolts yanked out, unhook the electrical, we'll trolley this thing over, let it down, wheel it out, and we'll get this thing replaced. Plate looks pretty decent from what I'm seeing from here. I don't think it would have done a doggone bit of good to change that plate, so that's one of the things I wanted to make sure of before I put that other compressor in there. That one looks fairly okay. It's broke on this one either. Before I pulled that other compressor and broke the seal on it. Nothing's damaged there. Or here. So, must have an issue here. Not seeing any damage down in there. Interesting. Something ain't right. Not sure what, but something definitely was not right. back into place, as you've seen. Just gotta get our suction line and our gas line hooked back up, pop out some pop outs, hook up some electrical, pull back on this unit, and get that pressure switch control replaced if they approve it. Gotta watch it because that thing's pressurized. That's why I didn't take it all the way out. It just released. I think blow your face off otherwise. You're talking about pressurizing metal. No room for expansion, it just pops. I am probably going to wire brush off that paint just to be safe that I've got a nice flat even surface. May not need to, but I haven't done a million of these, so I want to make dang sure that it's able to be gotten as tight as it possibly can without over tightening it and get proper seal. I was hoping that we'd be able to put that there to keep that crap out, but I just got to use a piece of duct tape. Like I've said before, this is POE oil. Just gonna put a little bit on there.
Quarter-inch hoses because the mass area inside that compressor head is not very large.
So we've got that done. We've got the pressure switch wired up to here. I got to get one more wire nut on there. I've got these looped with protective sheathing on it so it shouldn't vibrate. They're pretty strong. I put the loops down here so the weight was closest to the body. And so as soon as we get done with that, I'm going to let some refrigerant through. Once we're done with the vacuum, let some refrigerant through. And then check our seals, make sure nothing's leaking. I don't really recommend using nitrogen right here, because if there is a leak or if there's any leaking through the king valve, you'll push that nitrogen back into your suction line, most likely, and contaminate your refrigerant. And then you got 30 pounds of refrigerant that you're going to be pulling out and getting disposed of because you contaminated it with non-condensables such as nitrogen. I've been there, I've done it. I'm not a big believer in doing it when there's refrigerant in the system and you're isolated. Not a good idea. As you can tell, the system is pretty old, and it's very likely that those could leak. Once we get it running and everything's working good, we'll go ahead and then probably get that suction filter dryer out of there. It just depends. I'm going to double check things first before we get carried away with that. And then we're going to set up our pressure switches and things like that. Filter dryer, like I said, we used that just that one day. I'm going to check for any temperature drops across it. The refrigerant's new. The filter dryer's new. It only ran one day or so. I'm not worried about changing that again, because like I said, we isolated this thing, so the dryer, it's not got anything wrong with it, no sense of changing it again, unless there's a drop across it, which I am going to cut apart the dryer when I get home and show you what's inside there, because it did feel restricted when I blew through it. Okay, we got her pulled down into a vacuum. It's holding the vacuum. I'm going to go ahead and open up our valves here, see what we got, see whether she holds with the bubbles. I also routed those cap tubes so they're out of the way this time, whereas before it was right in the way of everything you were trying to do. I'm gonna soak down all this stuff here since we wiggled it a little bit. Really should have a vibration absorber on it, but we definitely got some this, and it's been like that for quite a while. Yeah, one of the things you kind of think about is, okay, the accumulator, do you have any problems with that not getting oil back to the compressor, which we have oil in the compressor previously, so I don't think we got a problem with oil return. We've got the accumulator on there, which should protect it away its flood back. But what took that other compressor out, we're going to have to find out. And I think it was more of other issues. Hard to say if it was the long defrost that we had. I'm going to see about hooking up that defrost termination yet. But for right now, I'm going to go ahead and get it powered back up, see what she does. Stand back. Shut down, which is good, because I've got the system in a defrost, if you remember correctly, which she shut off before, which is good because she wouldn't pull down at all before, and she's holding there. So let's take it out of the defrost, make sure where it comes on at, about 21-ish, which we may need to use our analog gauges to make sure that's accurate. But head pressure is going to be high all the same, because like I said, they've got a fan blade on order for this thing, and that one's not big enough, but it's better than not having one at all. It's moving some massive air, it's just not the right one for the job. Now I'm going to go ahead and pull that disconnect, see if it gets us a little more pressure onto that suction. 30-something. Want to make sure there's no leaks on that. Like I said, that gasket was a little weird. Why it wasn't exactly the same is beyond me. But from what I'm seeing, it looks like it sealed right up, no problem. I didn't have any more king valves. curious if it may be a little overcharged possibly now. A little hard to tell. May end up blowing some into the tank and remove some just in case, but it's definitely warm back here. Like I said, you've got a lot of air movement here, and air's run into this box. And there's louvers down there you can kind of see. So it brings the air in the front. I've already blown this condenser coil out, which you've seen in the last video. There'll be a link in the beginning. There'll be a link in the description if it doesn't pop up here. But that was the first part of this video. So got that. Let's see if we go into, I'm pretty sure this here don't shut down the solenoid. So let's go ahead and put it into the defrost, make sure it shuts off at a positive level. That'll give me a chance to double check it with the analog gauge. Whatever was wrong with that other compressor, it definitely didn't appear to be the valves. Must be the piston rings is all I can assume, possibly something in with the linkage of those. The head pressure's going down, so we're not doing too bad. Shutting off about 5. I might need to adjust that a bit. It may rapid cycle touch because the solenoid is back here. The freezer is just on the other side of this wall. It's not very far away at all. Came on right about 25. That should put us below 0, so we should be okay. Do a pump down again, make certain. These digital gauges just aren't quick enough. This did have a 50-minute defrost, and that just seems awfully long. I'd rather see 3 or 4 shorter ones than that long, long one that's just with no termination. That just ain't a good idea. I just adjusted that up to this, maybe a pound or so. I like that better. That's about 2 pounds. That seems to be holding a little better too. About 25. According to this, 25 PSI is -8 degrees on the dew point on 404. So that freezer should easily be able to come back on, even if it's cold outside, which it won't be too much here. And looks like it's starting to rain. I'm gonna have to get my lift inside the area here, but that should assure us that it comes on in the winter. All right, I had to take my indoor temperature at the evaporator, because they have like a subcooler's de-superheater loop at the coil, which is throwing my measurements off. We're running a -13 degree, and we got 23 degrees there, so we got about 36 degrees. Superheat's not the greatest in the world. It really needs to be adjusted, but we're not at box temperature yet. So head pressures came down because it rained and it's gotten cooler. But still, we're up there in the higher range, but it's, like I said, it's warm back here. So, unfortunately, it's a waiting game, and I've got other calls to run. Our sight glass is almost completely full. It's not your traditional bubbles. The flow of this thing just seems awfully slow. This is an old Hussman unit, and like I said, this thing is just old. It's, who knows how many compressors this thing's had by now and what kind of leaks they've had. Cause like I said, they've added the die crap to it already once back in 16. So we're gonna run it for a little bit, see how it's doing. It's dropping in temperature, box is around 20 degrees area. So we've got a little time yet before we can get down to temp. We shortened the defrost down to 30 minutes. We went for 3 of them for now. We got another person coming back to replace this fan blade. And like I said, with the ambient being kind of warm in here, I hate adding too much more refrigerant. This comes down to, I wish somebody would have wrote back in the day what the actual charge was. I really need to adjust that TXV. That could lower my head pressure and put things more in line. I tried the defrost termination here. The voltage on it made it, it wasn't right. I have a feeling this clock might have got burned up or something. that's why they changed it. As you can see, all the equipment's really tired. At what point do you just make it run and not try to make it absolutely perfect? Because, you know, it's they're running a humongo bill up by trying to make something this old new again, and you're just not going to accomplish it with really old condenser, really old evaporator. It's been through a hard life. It's been beat as a child, an abusive relationship. So, like I said, basically, we got everything set, pressure-wise, everything's pretty well ready to go. I just need to get that box down to temp so I can double-check that superheat. I brought some uni-strut there and a clamp to fix the line here, and it's not really shaking anymore. I think another compressor is shaking. Plus, the springs underneath of this, two of them are crushed, two of them are full size. So I put one that was full in the front, and one that was full in the back, opposite directions. And then the little ones that are crushed kind of still help balance it. So it's got some shaking now, able to shake, but it's not as unbalanced as what it was before, which made it a little bit better than what it was prior to. And other than that, I mean, everything checks out fine. I gotta double check my contactor, make sure there's nothing burned in it. Otherwise, I would wanna replace it. And that's about it. If you guys like the video and you want to see more like it, please give it a thumbs up. Until next time, guys, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. And most importantly, click that notification bell down below so you're notified when I release my next video. Until next time, we'll catch you guys on the next one. We're checking the pressure drop across that filter dryer right now. We're at pound 0.2. Okay, let's say 50. Let's go back down here. 5. Almost 6 degree drop across that stupid thing. Dang it. Well, we're gonna have to get that out of there real quick. Got it cut out. End up using 2/7/8. Couplings and a short piece in between it, pulled it back on the suction line, sucked anything out that got in between here, good to go. Pressure's about the same, temperature's about the same. There's another guy coming back, like I said, about the fan blade. I'm gonna have him double check the refrigerant charge when the box is at temperature. Other than that, we're gonna wrap this thing up right now. There's no way I can really rush through it. It's already 3 o'clock and I've got to go another place yet, so basically we'll see how it does and then we can make the adjustments at that point. Right now I can't stay any longer, I got shit to do. So anyhow, even when you don't want to do it, you still got to do it right. So we did it as good as we could.